Our Bible reading is from 1 Kings chapter 22, starting at verse 51, and then reading through into 2 Kings and reading all of chapter 1. And that starts on page 367 in the Bibles in the pews. First Kings chapter 22, verse 51. Ahaziah, son of Ahab, became king of Israel in Samaria in the 17th year of Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, and he reigned over Israel for 2 years. He did evil in the eyes of the Lord, because he walked in the ways of his father and mother, and in the ways of Jeroboam, son of Nebat, who caused Israel to sin. He served and worshipped Baal, and provoked the Lord, the God of Israel, to anger, just as his father had done. After Ahab's death, Moab rebelled against Israel. Now Ahaziah had fallen through the lattice of his upper room in Samaria and injured himself. So he sent messengers, saying to them, "Go and consult Baal-zebub, the god of Ekron, to see if I will recover from this injury." But the angel of the Lord said to Elijah the Tishbite, "Go up and meet the messengers of the king of Samaria and ask them, 'Is it because there is no God in Israel that you are going off to consult Baal-zebub, the god of Ekron?' Therefore, this is what the Lord says, 'You will not leave the bed you are lying on. You will certainly die.'" So Elijah went. When the messengers returned to the king, he asked them, "Why have you come back?" "A man came to meet us," they replied, "and he said to us, 'Go back to the king who sent you and tell him, this is what the Lord says. Is it because there is no God in Israel that you are sending men to consult Baal-zebub, the god of Ekron? Therefore, you will not leave the bed you are lying on. You will certainly die.'" The king asked them, "What kind of man was it who came to meet you and told you this?" They replied, "He was a man with a garment of hair and with a leather belt round his waist." The king said, "That was Elijah the Tishbite." Then he sent to Elijah a captain with his company of 50 men. The captain went up to Elijah, who was sitting on the top of a hill, and said to him, "Man of God, the king says, come down." Elijah answered the captain, "If I am a man of God, may fire come down from heaven and consume you and your 50 men." Then the fire fell from heaven and consumed the captain and his men. At this, the king sent to Elijah another captain with his 50 men. The captain said to him, "Man of God, this is what the king says. Come down at once." "If I am a man of God," Elijah replied, "may fire come down from heaven and consume you and your 50 men." Then the fire of God fell from heaven and consumed him and his 50 men. So the king sent a third captain with his 50 men. This third captain went up and fell on his knees before Elijah. "Man of God," he begged, "please have respect for my life and the lives of these 50 men, your servants. See, fire has fallen from heaven and consumed the first two captains and all their men. But now have respect for my life." The angel of the Lord said to Elijah, "Go down with him. Do not be afraid of him." So Elijah got up and went down with him to the king. He told the king, "This is what the Lord says. Is it because there is no God in Israel for you to consult that you have sent messengers to consult Baal-zebub, the god of Ekron? Because you have done this, you will never leave the bed you are lying on. You will certainly die." So he died, according to the word of the Lord that Elijah had spoken. Because Ahaziah had no son, Joram succeeded him as king in the second year of Jehoram, son of Jehoshaphat, king of Judah. As for all the other events of Ahaziah's reign and what he did, are they not written in the book of the annals of the kings of Israel?
We are going to continue our scripture reading now in 2 Kings, and we're going to pick up our reading in 2 Kings chapter 2. So we're on page 369 in the Pew Bibles. So page 369 in the Pew Bibles, 2 Kings chapter 2, and let's continue to hear God's word. When the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven in a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here. The Lord has sent me to Bethel." But Elisha said, "As surely as the Lord lives, and as you live, I will not leave you." So they went down to Bethel. The company of the prophets at Bethel came out to Elisha and asked, "Do you know that the Lord is going to take your master from you today?" "Yes, I know," Elisha replied, "but do not speak of it." Then Elijah said to him, "Stay here, Elisha. The Lord has sent me to Jericho." And he replied, "As surely as the Lord lives and as you live, I will not leave you." So they went to Jericho. The company of the prophets at Jericho went up to Elisha and asked him, "Do you know that the Lord is going to take your master from you today?" "Yes, I know," he replied, "but do not speak of it." Then Elijah said to him, "Stay here. The Lord has sent me to the Jordan." And he replied, "As surely as the Lord lives and as you live, I will not leave you." So the two of them walked on. 50 men of the company of the prophets went and stood at a distance, facing the place where Elijah and Elisha had stopped at the Jordan. Elijah took his cloak, rolled it up, and struck the water with it. The water divided to the right and to the left, and the two of them crossed over on dry ground. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Tell me, what can I do for you before I am taken from you? Let me inherit a double portion of your spirit," Elisha replied. "You have asked a difficult thing," Elijah said. "Yet if you see me when I am taken from you, it will be yours, otherwise not." As they were walking along and talking together, suddenly a chariot of fire and horses of fire appeared and separated the two of them, and Elijah went up to heaven in a whirlwind. Elisha saw this and cried out, "My father, my father, the chariot and horsemen of Israel." And Elisha saw him no more. Then he took hold of his own clothes and tore them apart. He picked up the cloak that had fallen from Elijah and went back and stood on the bank of the Jordan. Then he took the cloak that had fallen from him and struck the water with it. "Where now is the Lord, the God of Elijah?" he asked. When he struck the water, it divided to the right and to the left, and he crossed over. The company of the prophets from Jericho, who were watching, said, "The spirit of Elijah is resting on Elisha." And they went to meet him and bowed to the ground before him. "Look," they said, "we, your servants, have 50 able men. Let them go and look for your master. Perhaps the spirit of the Lord has picked him up and set him down on some mountain or in some valley." "No," Elijah replied, "do not send them." But they persisted until he was too ashamed to refuse. So he said, "Send them." And they sent 50 men who searched for 3 days but did not find him. When they returned to Elisha, who was staying in Jericho, he said to them, "Didn't I tell you not to go?" The men of the city said to Elisha, "Look, our Lord, this town is well situated, as you can see, but the water is bad and the land is unproductive. Bring me a new bowl," he said, "and put salt in it." So they brought it to him. Then he went out to the spring and threw salt into it, saying, "This is what the Lord says, I have healed this water. Never again will it cause death or make the land unproductive." And the water has remained wholesome to this day, according to the word Elisha had spoken. From there, Elisha went up to Bethel. As he was walking along the road, some youths came out of the town and jeered at him. "Go on up, you bald head," they said. "Go on up, you bald head." He turned round, looked at them, and called down a curse on them in the name of the Lord. Then two bears came out of the woods and mauled 42 of the youths. And he went on to Mount Carmel, and from there returned to Samaria. And this is God's word. Well, as we come to open up God's word together, let's pray. And I'm going to use a simple prayer that comes from the book of 1 Samuel. Do you remember when Samuel goes into the priest Eli at night because he's been hearing the Lord speak to him. And Eli says to Samuel this prayer. So let's pray it together. Our Father God, it is our prayer tonight that you would speak, Lord, for your servants are listening. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, we're beginning this new series in 2 Kings. It's going to take us most of the way till Easter time. We're calling it The Power and the Glory. I understand that this follows on from series in 1 Samuel, in 2 Samuel, and in 1 Kings over the past number of years. But you may well have a feeling tonight of, I don't know, being in a sci-fi film that's run on for a large number of series, and you're kind of reading it, and you're not quite sure what the plot lines were, and so you might be feeling slightly confused. Well, what we're going to do tonight is ease our way into episode 4, 2 Kings, and try and get a sense of where we are. We're going to kind of take some time to look around before getting into a little bit, at least, of these two chapters. So without further ado then, let's start by taking a look forward. 2 Kings is normally classed as one of the history books of the Bible, telling the history of God's people in the Old Testament under the kings of Israel and Judah. And if you're one of those people who, as soon as the word history is mentioned, your head kind of metaphorically hits the pew in front of you, because history at school was deadly dull, this bit is for you. This book of history is not the dry and dusty, here's all the facts, here's everything that happened, let me give it all to you. We actually had a mention in our reading of that book. It existed. Do you see in chapter 1, verse 18, there's this book of the annals of the kings of Israel. So there's much more that the writer could have said. But what we have in 1 and 2 Kings is 500 years of history. So think from Elizabeth I to Elizabeth II in our context. 500 years of history compressed down to a book that today would take up about 100 pages if it was published as a normal book today. This is really compressed history. 500 years into 100 pages. And so it's history with a purpose. This is history written to tell us something, to show us something. It's sort of more like history as a tract or a pamphlet. This is history with an agenda. And to see what it is, I want us to look forward to the very end, almost, of 2 Kings. So can you keep a finger in chapters 1 and 2 and turn to 2 Kings chapter 24. We're going to fast forward to the very last days of Jerusalem. So 2 Kings chapter 24, verse 1. And we read here, this is the penultimate chapter. During Jehoiakim's reign, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, invaded the land. And Jehoiakim became his vassal for 3 years. But then he changed his mind and rebelled against Nebuchadnezzar. The Lord sent Babylonian, Aramean, Moabite, and Ammonite raiders against him. He sent them to destroy Judah in accordance with the word of the Lord, proclaimed by his servants the prophets. Surely these things happened to Judah according to the Lord's command. So what we're reading about here, there's lots of details that we'll hopefully get more of a sense of in the weeks to come. But what we're seeing here is really the one of the kind of the epitaph on Jerusalem and Judah, this great kingdom that had been promised would be an eternal kingdom that would last forever. Do you remember the promise God made to King David that he would have an everlasting kingdom? Well, here we're finding that kingdom with those promises was destroyed by Babylonians and other invaders in 587 BC, okay? Disaster, catastrophe, and that would have involved all the normal catastrophes of war. All the bloodshed, all of the post-traumatic stress, all of the upheaval, all of the economic and social implications that war normally involves. But for the people who survived that war, there was more than an ordinary catastrophe going on. They were deported to Babylon and were exiles there. And for the people who lived through that time and for the generations afterwards, they had perhaps an even bigger issue that they had to deal with. I think they would have been wondering what had happened to all those promises that God had given to King David and many other promises, promises that we had got an everlasting kingdom, and now it's been destroyed. They not only had a kind of an economic and civil and military crisis, they had a crisis of faith. What worth was all God's word now? What was the point of it all? If God could say that this kingdom would last forever, and then it collapses in ruins. Well, those are natural questions. And I think 1 and 2 Kings was inspired by God as a kind of history with a purpose to answer that question. And I think what we're seeing here in chapter 24 is just the beginnings of the answer to that we'll see, I think, a lot more over the coming weeks. Do you see what the inspired author of this book is wanting to tell us about why these things happened? The Lord sent Babylonians, verse 2, and these other raiders to destroy Judah in accordance with the word of the Lord proclaimed by his servants, the prophets. Surely these things happened to Judah according to the Lord's command. See what he's saying? He's saying the exile didn't happen because God's word failed. The exile happened because God's word is true. Because God's word was faithful and was being fulfilled. And so that's a kind of a sketch, I think, of what we're going to see as we go through 2 Kings. So as we look forward, we're going to see that the word of God stands forever. I think that's the big point of 2 Kings. Amidst all the disaster, the word of God stands forever. Remember what Jesus said, heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will stand forever. I think that begins to open up for us something of how 2 Kings is going to be relevant to us. This is not just ancient history of a people who lived long ago. This is people who shared our faith, who had promises that we have too. And we too may well find ourselves wondering in our day what worth the promises of God's kingdom really are. We live in a society that has been profoundly shaped by Christianity, by the Word of God. Some of you have perhaps come across this book by Tom Holland that came out last year. It has been topping a lot of the bestseller lists nationally. It's called Dominion, The Making of the Western Mind. I haven't got to reading it yet, but I've seen a lot about it, a lot of reviews about it that suggest it's very good. It might be an enjoyable book to have a look at. Basically, his theory, or what his argument, is that Western values, Western civilization, is basically shaped by Christian values. Everybody who lives around us is basically operating with something of a Christian worldview. That's his argument. And yet what we're seeing all around us is that is now falling to pieces, isn't it? Every week, it seems, there's some news story that shows just how far away our society now is turning from its inheritance. And so we might wonder where the promises of God's kingdom really are. And we look at ourselves here in church, and so often we find declining numbers. Where are the promises of God's kingdom? Well, 2 Kings, I think, is going to help us as we work through it to see that amidst all of that, the word of God really does stand forever. So that's a look forward. A little flavour of where we're going and why this matters. We also need to take a look back as we begin this journey through 2 Kings. Because 2 Kings very clearly picks up on where 1 Kings left off. And so you probably got a sense of that in the reading. We saw Ahaziah's reign kind of begins at the very end of 2 Kings, and then we read about it there in chapter 1. But there is a little bit of a sense of 2 Kings kind of starting again, of beginning kind of episode 4 in the story, because we get a recap in verse 1. Chapter 1, verse 1 of 2 Kings says this: after Ahab's death, Moab rebelled against Israel. Now, if we'd been reading through 1 Kings, we'd already know about Ahab's death. This is a flashback. This is a recap. And it's quite an interesting way to begin the book. It's actually quite a common way that biblical books begin. So the book of Joshua begins with the death of Moses. The book of Judges begins with the death of Joshua. The book of 2 Samuel begins with the death of Saul. And the book of 1 Kings begins with the death, an extended account, of the death of David. And so in each of these kind of times when a Bible book begins with a death, that's because there's a big shift taking place. I think we called this sermon a seismic shift. There's a kind of a succession, there's a change as one leader goes and a new leader takes their place. And so that's what we've got here. But as we're expecting a kind of a succession, a change as Ahab dies. But it also encourages us, I think, to go back to 1 Kings and to the death of David, and almost to compare the start of 1 Kings and the start of 2 Kings. There's only 120 years between the death of David and the death of Ahab, but there is a world of difference between the states of the nation in those two times. So let's go back quickly to the time of David and then his son Solomon. That was the time when God made that great promise to David, that he would have an everlasting kingdom that would never fail, that he would never lack for a son to reign on the throne of Israel, that his son would be always called the Son of God. Great promises given in the time of David. And God began to fulfill them. That was when the empire of Israel reached its furthest expansion, went as far down as Egypt in the south and in the west, and then as far east as Moab in and then not only that, but then Solomon builds the wonderful temple that we all know about, a temple covered in gold and silver and bronze and cedar wood, a place to worship the God of Israel as he has called us to. So those were really the glory days of Israel, the days of silver and gold and wealth and riches and wisdom and worship. But 120 years later, with Ahab's death, it is a totally different story. Ahab is not a king who reigns in Jerusalem, because ever since the time of Solomon's successor, Rehoboam, 10 of the 12 tribes of Israel have been in revolt against the Davidic king who reigns in Jerusalem. And Ahab is one of those kings who ruled the northern 10 tribes, and they're known as the Kingdom of Israel. And so the death of Ahab is the death of somebody who's actually in rebellion against the Davidic king who reigns in Jerusalem over the remaining two tribes, and that's the Kingdom of Judah, worth taking note of that. Northern Kingdom, Israel, Southern Kingdom, Judah. So there's this division of God's people. Lots of them are in rebellion against God's king. And the empire is fragmenting. And you can see there in our verse, Moab rebelled against Israel. So bits of it are breaking off. And the reason for that is that the glories of true worship of God in the temple in Jerusalem have now been replaced by rampant idolatry all across the land. And Ahab was the worst offender. 1 Kings says that Ahab did more to provoke the Lord, the God of Israel, to anger than all the kings of Israel who were before him. And so this is a nation where the glory is fading. 120 years after the glory days of Solomon and David, we're in a time when the nation is under judgment. And those are the days of Elijah. God raises up this prophet Elijah to prophesy during the reign of wicked King Ahab, to prophesy judgment on Ahab and on his house. And we'll be seeing lots of that judgment being worked out in 2 Kings. And this is what we need to see then as we take a look back. We need to see that in the days of Elijah, the glory was already fading. And so in many ways, living in Israel in the time of 2 Kings actually wasn't that different to living in Babylon after the exile. And so for that matter, it wasn't that different to living in Belfast today. The people in 2 Kings were living under godless, wicked kings who had turned their backs on God, along with most of society. The glory was already fading. And so the pressing question that we'll see time and time again in 2 Kings that translates right across to us is, how are we going to live when the glory is fading? Are we going to be faithful to the God of Israel, even when so many others turn their back on him? And in chapter 1 here, we get a little illustration of this issue of how we're going to live when the glory is fading. I'm not going to go through the story. Rachel read it really well for us, and hopefully you got the picture of what's going on in the story. I want to just focus us in on this third captain in chapter 1, verse 13. So Elijah the prophet is up sitting on top of a hill, and he's been refusing to come down at the imperious demand of the king. And the king has sent a third captain with his 50 men. And this third captain goes up, and instead of demanding that Elijah come down at the command of the king, he falls on his knees before Elijah. "Man of God," he begged, "please have respect for my life and the lives of these 50 men, your servants. See, fire has fallen from heaven and consumed the first two captains and all their men. But now, have respect for my life." So put yourself in the shoes of this captain, this third captain. He is under the command of a wicked, godless king, King Ahaziah, a king who, when he falls ill, doesn't pray to God, doesn't seek God, doesn't wonder what's going on in terms of asking God. Instead, he sends messengers to go and ask the god of Ekron, who's called Baalzebub. Baalzebub is how that's translated in the New Testament, and literally it means the Lord of the Flies. Now, we don't know whether there literally was a god called the Lord of the Flies, or whether that's a kind of a name that the Bible uses for this god, but it doesn't paint a good picture, does it? This wicked king is choosing to go and seek after the Lord of the Flies, a nothing god, a worthless god, a god of gnats. And he's forcing everybody to do his will. And so he demands that the prophet Elijah come down from his mountain and come to the palace for some interrogation right away. And Elijah calls down fire from heaven on the first group of soldiers who try to arrest him. So undeterred, the king sends a second group. And they try to arrest Elijah. And again, they are consumed with fire from heaven as they try to carry out the arrogant demands of their master. And undeterred, Ahaziah sends a third group. Can you understand the arrogance of this man, Ahaziah? Now think about what it would be like to be that captain. You've got orders to go and get Elijah, come what may. That's what it's like to live in a society ruled by a godless king. What are you going to do? Well, this captain knows enough about reality to know that even if his master's telling him to worship the nothing Lord of the Flies, the made-up gods, the fantasies that his master is imposing upon everyone, he knows enough to ignore all that and instead to fall down on his knees before the man of God, the man who can call down fire from heaven, because he fears the Lord of the Fire much more than the Lord of the Flies. And that's the question for us, isn't it? Are we going to fear the Lord of the Fire more than the people who command us to worship the nothing gods that our society is imposing on us? We don't have too much time to get into this, but I think you can see all around our society, as we turn away from a biblical understanding of reality, society is increasingly embracing fantasy and telling us to submit to it. So I'm thinking here particularly of the gender issue. Our society increasingly doesn't believe that gender is a real thing, that you're either male or female. And so it says gender you can just make up and be whatever you like. And now it's saying you have to believe that. And that's like the Lord, that's like believing and worshipping the Lord of the Flies. It's imposing that on us. And we're going to have to ask whether we are going to go along with these imposed, made-up beliefs, or whether we're going to worship the Lord of the fire. So those are the kind of questions that confront us as the glory is fading. And we'll see more of that as we go on. But if we are going to live for God, we're going to need to be very clear, I think, of who our God is and what happens as we follow him. And that's what we get as we finally take a look up in chapter 2 at the ascension of Elijah. This is really the focal point of these two chapters. Everything in these two chapters either leads towards this moment when Elijah ascends into heaven or flows out from it. And so there's plenty of drama as we build up to this great event. Chapter 2, verse 1, Elijah and Elisha were together on their way from Gilgal. And Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here, the Lord has sent me to Bethel." And Elisha refuses to leave his master. He says three times in chapter 2, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." As I was reading it, it was hard to know whether this was comedy or not, because it's sort of repeated so many times. I don't know, but it's very clear either way that we're really meant to take this seriously, what Elisha says here. "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." This is a pretty normal way of speaking in the Bible. It's kind of a way that people said something really strongly, "as you yourself live and as the Lord lives." But I think in the context of this passage, it takes on a sort of an extra meaning. The question that we had three times in chapter 1 is it because there's no God in Israel that you're going off to consult Beelzebub, the god of Ekron? Is it because there's no God? Is it because there's no God? Okay, that's the sort of the question that's hanging in the air. And Elisha, as he refuses to separate from his master, says, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live." Very clear that Elisha really does believe that the Lord lives. And so he's going to take his decisions on that basis. And he not only believes that the Lord lives, but he also believes that Elijah is the man of God. And so he's not going to separate himself from either the Lord or his servant, Elijah. Okay, that's the first kind of thing that happens as we're building up to Elijah's ascension. The second thing that happens is we keep meeting the company of the prophets or the sons of the prophets. We're not quite sure who these people are. Probably they're kind of like hangers-on to the prophets, people who are convinced of the prophet's message and want to follow it. So they're kind of a little bit of a picture of the church, of the faithful people in Old Testament Israel when many people have turned away from God. And twice these prophets say to Elisha, verse 3, "Do you know that the Lord is going to take your master from you today?" "Yes, I know," Elisha replied, "but do not speak of it." This, I think, is really building the tension, isn't it? As this is repeated, we're getting a sense of just how big a deal this is for Elisha. His master's going to be taken away from him. The man of God is going. And so Elisha says, "Do not speak of it." And literally, the question, what the sons of the prophets say is, "Do you know that the Lord is going to take your master from above your head today?" And again, I think this is a fairly common way of speaking. You know, your master is kind of somebody who's over your head. And so they're saying he's going to take him from over your head. But again, I think this kind of common phrase takes on an extra meaning here. Because literally, while Elijah and Elisha are walking and talking by the Jordan River, suddenly this chariot of fire pulled by fiery horses comes down from heaven and separates the two of them. And Elijah is whisked off up to heaven in a fiery chariot. And Elisha sees this and he calls out, my father, the chariot of Israel and its horsemen." And so Elisha is being shown what is really above his head. It's this fiery chariot of the Lord. That's where the real authority lies. That's where the real power lies. Chariots in the ancient world were the most powerful weapon on the ancient battlefield. And Ahab was not short of chariots. According to one source that's outside the Bible, he could field 2,000 chariots in one important battle. But this passage is very clear that there's really only one chariot that matters. Israel's true chariot is not Ahab's thousands of chariots. It is the fiery chariot of the Lord of hosts. That is where the power is. That is where the glory is. And this is a theme that we're going to come back to in the weeks to come. This very striking image. We almost look, don't we, with Elisha as he sees Elijah going off up to heaven in this fiery chariot. And it seems to me that a big part of what 2 Kings is saying to us is when the glory is fading, when you're doubting if God's word is true, you need to take a look up. You need to look at what's above your head. And what's above our heads is the Lord of hosts, the Lord of the fire, the one who can send down fire not only in judgment on people who oppose him and who oppose his servants, but who can also come to deliver his servants and bring them up to his presence in heaven. So when the glory is fading, when we're in our kind of secular context and we're doubting everything that's going on, or when we're feeling like the church is falling apart and we're not up to scratch, look up. Look at what's above your head and see the fiery chariot of Elijah. Well, we're nearly done. Just in wrapping up, there's one more. The rest of the passage, we don't have time to look at it, really. But essentially, flowing out from this, we see that Elisha is the true successor of Elijah. And perhaps the clearest way that we see this is as Elisha's kind of left now in the silence after this great spectacle, he looks round and he sees on the ground Elijah's cloak. It's been dropped by Elijah as Elijah's being whisked up to heaven. And so Elisha picks it up. And as he does that, he is literally taking up the mantle of Elijah. That's the old-fashioned word for a cloak, and that's where this phrase comes from, taking on somebody's mantle. Well, Elisha takes on the mantle of Elisha. He asks that he would receive Elijah's spirit, and he does. And I think as we take a step back from these two chapters, that is really the big point. There is a seismic shift going on in these chapters. There is a transition of leadership, but it's not really about these kings. They don't really matter with their faithlessness and their godlessness. Ahab dies, his son Ahaziah dies without an heir in chapter 1, and it doesn't really matter because the focus now is on these men of God. Elijah passing on his mantle to Elisha. Now, that's not to say that kings don't matter anymore. The promises of a true king to come are still there. They're still really important. But in these days where the glory's fading, where people have turned away from God, where the kings have turned away from God, what the people needed to focus on in 2 Kings and in exile in Babylon and in the years to come was on the prophets, because God's word would stand firm, the word that came through the prophets, even when the kings were corrupt and there was no sign of the promised king. And I think that's where we are today, here in Belfast, thousands of years later. Now, the true king has come. We've got the Lord Jesus. He's ascended and on his throne. But we're still waiting, aren't we, for him to come. And what we have now is we don't look to earthly kingdoms for where the power and the glory is. Because the true king is yet to come. Where we look now for God's activity is in the people who have taken up the mantle of Elijah. Well, maybe not. I've overstated that slightly. I'll try and nuance that in a second. In the letters to Timothy, Paul twice calls Timothy the man of God. So he suggests that ministers of the gospel have taken on the mantle of Elijah. And what's their job? To preach the word in season and out of season with great patience and careful instruction. Preach the word. It seems to me that that is saying that this is how God works now at the moment in our world. As we wait for the true king to come, we don't look to the crowns and kingdoms of the world for the power and the glory. We instead look to the prophet's mantle as it's passed on through the living word of God and as it's opened up by God's appointed messengers, by ministers of the gospel. People like Frank, people like, in a sort of a sense, like me. You can maybe think of Frank as the kind of the Elijah figure in this group, and I'm like the kind of Elisha figure before he really takes on the job properly, that kind of a thing. Now, obviously, we're not quite like prophets like that. We're tied to God's written word in a way that these prophets were not. But I think that's what we're doing. We're wanting to hear God's word, to hear the word that endures forever. And so that means, I think, that what we're doing here tonight, on a Sunday evening, in the first Sunday of January, is exactly the right thing to be doing. We're here to listen to God's word being opened up. Because we know that's where the power and the glory is. That's how God is working in our world, through his word being proclaimed by his servants in the scriptures. Even when the glory is fading, this book of 2 Kings is going to show us that God's word stands forever and that the Lord of the fire, who comes down in judgment and salvation, will still speak and work today through his living word, the words spoken by the prophets, and most of all through his son, the one who he appointed heir of all things. So let's listen to that living word, and so through him and with him be praise and authority to the Father with the Holy Spirit forever and ever. Amen. Let's pray, shall we? Our Father in heaven, we have just begun to dip our toe into these waters of 2 Kings. And we want to say thank you for inspiring this book and giving it to us for our instruction. And as we go back to these days of the prophets and these days of these idolatrous kings, we pray that you would teach us how to live for you in our day. Lord, we pray that our ears might be always open to your living word, that our eyes might be always on your heavenly kingdom, and that we might walk in the footsteps of Elijah and Elisha, and all the sons of the prophets. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's pray. In our prayers for others this evening, we will pray for things globally, locally, in our church family, and for mission. Heavenly Father, we've been horrified by the scale of and devastation caused by the ongoing wildfires in Australia, as we've seen images unfold on our TV screens. As we pray about that situation, we use the words of a prayer specifically written by Pete Gregg of the 24/7 prayer movement. We pray today for those who've lost homes or even loved ones in the fires. Father of compassion and God of all comfort, give strength to the emergency services fighting the fire, resilience to medics tending the sick, and compassion to pastors conducting funerals and binding up broken hearts. We also ask you to give wisdom to politicians as they seek to respond effectively to this crisis and as they begin to review long-term environmental policies in light of this disaster. Forgive us, Lord, for the damage we are doing by exploiting our environment and failing to care for your creation. We find ourselves confronted once again by the terrifying fragility of life. Have mercy on us. The psalmist says that you cover the sky with clouds and supply the earth with rain. Would you hear our desperate prayers, redirect the winds and send heavy unseasonal rains upon millions of acres currently ablaze in the beautiful land of Australia. Close to home, Father, we've also been horrified by the bad news we've heard over the past few days. A teenage cyclist knocked down and killed in Belfast. A suspicious death in Dungannon. The body of a missing teenager found in Warren Point today. Behind each of these headlines are families and friends plunged into grief who we lift before you now. Would they know the peace and comfort that only you can bring? Please journey with each of these bereaved families as they walk through the valley of the shadow of death. As we sang with our children this morning, we pray that each of these families would know that you are good and faithful, and that they would indeed run to Jesus. Father, we thank you for our church family here in Bloomfield. At the start of this new year, would we as individuals and as a church family resolve to be based in the Bible, passionate about people, and centered on Christ. We pray for Frank and Sam and ask that you would give them insight into your word and clarity of mind as they faithfully teach us week by week. We pray for our elders and ask that they would exercise wise and godly leadership. And as our organizations get underway for the new term, we pray for creativity for leaders. We pray that this would be a safe place for all who attend. And most of all, we pray for the growth of your kingdom. We go to all the world with kingdom hope unfurled. No other name has power to save but Jesus Christ the Lord. Father, we give you thanks for Helen, for her commitment to you and her commitment to serving you in Japan. As she prepares to go back, we pray that she would sense you going ahead of her and with her. Would you equip Helen with all that she needs for the term of service that lies ahead? We thank you for the new OMF missionaries heading to Japan this spring, and pray that you would raise up people to fill the other open positions. Father, we are all on mission in schools, colleges, workplaces, homes, and communities. Help us to be people who carry the light of your gospel into the places to which you have called each of us. We pray all these things in Jesus' name and for his glory. Amen.